Dear Work, Something Has to Change. Written and narrated by Sara Ross. Dear Work, I need to start by saying you are an important part of my life and have provided me a deep sense of purpose and joy. You've allowed me to test myself and express myself and have given me a way to contribute to something bigger. You've challenged me to learn and grow, to do work that matters to me, and I am truly grateful. But admittedly, Work, it's getting harder to stay connected to the good things. Too often you take over my life, and when this happens, my priorities, happiness, and even my confidence seem to hinge on you. It's impossible to ignore that the pace, the intensity, and the sacrifices all come at a high price. I know it, and those who love me have let me know it too. The thing is, the satisfaction and energy that I get when things are going well are not far off memories. Some days are amazing and I remember exactly what I love about you. But if I'm honest, the gaps between the good days are getting bigger and most days it feels like I'm just treading water. What scares me the most is that the harder I work, the further behind I feel. There rarely seems to be enough time for everything. I feel stuck in this never-ending cycle where the demands keep coming, but the bar of success keeps rising, and I'm tired. Is this what I want my life to be? Do I have what it takes, or do I need to temper my drive, to stop giving so much or being so passionate? There must be another option. I love you, Work, or I used to, but something has to change. Exhaustedly, but still yours, Sara. Introduction. The letter you just heard lives in a wooden box tucked away in the corner of my office closet. That box is full of various letters I've written throughout my life. Now, you may be thinking, isn't the purpose of writing a letter to send it? Usually, yes. When I have things on my mind that I can't sort out or emotions that weigh heavily on my heart, I write letters and I don't send them. The process creates space between me and my experiences, and it helps me to see things with a fuller perspective. I've written them since I was young, and I do it to this day. The only difference with the letter you just heard was until that moment, I'd always written letters to people. But the day I wrote to Work, I was feeling both maxed out by the pressure of multiple impending deadlines and worn out by the hours I'd been putting in to meet them. I was just about to text friends to cancel, for the second time, on plans we had for later that evening when, distractedly reaching for my phone, I knocked over my coffee, spilling it to the floor. As I tried to clean it up before it stained the carpet, I was overcome with a sense of utter frustration and total exhaustion. And in hindsight, fear. Not because of some spilled coffee, but because in that moment, I had to admit to myself that after I had experienced near burnout in my last sales role, changed jobs, and careers for that matter, I again found myself on the same path. More maddening was that I'd had multiple experiences before this instance prompting me to make changes. My body was throwing up all sorts of red flags, warning me that I was pushing it too hard and not caring for it enough. And still, I couldn't seem to break out of the cycle of overworking and continuously sacrificing the things that mattered. Deep down, I was scared that the only way I could be successful was to keep going like this. And if I couldn't, what would that mean for my future goals? But if I did, what would be the cost? Our relationship to work. Like any relationship, our relationship to work can be complicated. This is especially true if you are someone who loves your work, feels it's a meaningful and an important element of your life, and you're committed to being successful at it. The challenge is we give and give, expecting work to reciprocate our commitment. We wait for it to make us feel worthy, to recognize our efforts, and to signal that we've done enough for the day and that it's okay to take a break. And when work just keeps coming, regardless of our capacity or circumstances, we blame it for consuming and depleting us, for causing us to doubt ourselves, or for not allowing us to be happy. While many important factors contribute to your relationship with work, let's be very clear. No matter how much you give to your work and sacrifice in the name of passion, dedication, and loyalty, work cannot love you back. There is only one person in your relationship with work, which means that you are the only one who can fulfill your plea for change. If you wait for work to change, you'll always feel stuck, which is exactly where I found myself. As I sat on my office floor that day, I realized that when it came to work and my relationship with it, something needed to change. And I knew it wasn't just me that felt this way. The survival zone. At the time I wrote that letter to work, I was the global head of leadership research and innovation at an organization where I regularly assessed, trained, and coached leaders and their people in the skills of emotional intelligence. While many were successful and enjoyed their work again and again, in hushed voices, as if they were admitting to something that only they experienced, clients would make a confession. Regardless of how passionate they were about their careers or how committed they were to their jobs, they often felt stuck in what I refer to as the survival zone. While it wasn't all of the time, it was too often, and that was the problem. Some explained being in survival mode as having too much to do and not enough time for anything else in the rest of their lives. For others, it was being stuck in autopilot, existing but not fully living, leaving them disillusioned with work and with little hope for change in the future. Much like myself, many experienced it as the pattern of pushing themselves to the brink of exhaustion, dialing it back, promising themselves and others they'd create better balance in the future, only to find the same frustrating cycle repeating too soon. And then there were those who had run on fumes for so long that they'd hit empty, and as a result had moved into an entirely different zone, the burnout zone. I distinctly recall a conversation with a client who depicted the cycle of the survival zone the following way. He said, "I used to love my work, but now, night after night, I fall into bed drained, only to wake up exhausted. Looking at the week ahead, my mindset has become to simply get through it. I find myself wishing the days away, waiting for the weekend, and then I miss out on most of the weekend, either because I'm thinking about the work I should be doing or dreading the work that awaits me in the week ahead." Given the estimate that most people will spend close to 90,000 hours working, that is a lot of time to be wished away, wanting things to change, and waiting for a weekend, vacation, or retirement. There was a longing in the stories that I heard. Following a keynote I delivered for a business association, a gentleman approached me with notable shame in his voice, and he asked, "I want to be a better leader for my people, but most days, I just feel too tired to do it. Is there something wrong with me?" We aren't broken, but with stress, burnout, and job resignation being reported at record highs, something about the way we are working certainly isn't working. Shortly after writing my letter to work, I started my company BrainAmped, a leadership research firm to better understand what change needed to happen when it came to our relationship to work. I dove deeply into the academic research. I administered surveys, pored over company performance reviews and leadership assessments, and conducted dozens and dozens of interviews. All the way through, checking and calibrating my findings with companies I advised, audiences I spoke to, and clients that I coached. And after all the research and testing, including through a global pandemic, what I learned about our relationship to work is the following. First, the experience of feeling stuck in the survival zone is pervasive. Second, while there is a desire to change the relationship between overworking and underliving, it's often hindered by the general belief that succeeding in one area requires sacrificing another. To excel at work means settling for an element of exhaustion, because that's the only way to get everything done. And having a fuller, more energy-fueled life requires settling for an element of mediocrity at work, because that's the only way to get everything done. Either way, there's always an undesirable trade-off. And third, as prevalent as points one and two are, there are everyday people working in similarly stress-filled environments that do so with a sense of aliveness, and thus are having a very different experience with work. The standout zone. These everyday people described in point three range from bankers, lawyers, and air traffic controllers to surgeons, dentists, and engineers. Some are leaders at Fortune 500 companies, and others are individual contributors working for nonprofits. They also include nurses, service operators, teachers, owners of small businesses, and ambitious entrepreneurs working to make their side hustle a full-time gig. To be clear, it's not that these people are charismatic, extroverted, peppy go-getters bounding out of bed every day because they love their work so much. In fact, many work quite the opposite. Nor are they untouched by stress or entirely avoided getting pulled into the survival zone. They experienced their fair share of both. Rather, the difference was that they didn't get stuck feeling trapped in trade-offs or defined by their circumstances. While there are always some sacrifices that need to be made, they recognize more readily when these sacrifices result in working from the survival zone and deliberately devise an exit strategy to get back out. As a result, they spend more time working from what I call the standout zone. While working in the survival zone is predicated on exhaustion, disillusionment, and sacrifice-based trade-offs, the standout zone is the opposite. It's characterized by deliberate choices and actions where people feel motivated and capable of bringing their best to what they do in the most energizing and healthy way. Whether with a quiet, caring groundedness or a palpable state of enthusiasm, these everyday people working from their standout zone infuse a sense of aliveness into the projects that they work on, the people they work with, and the pursuits that matter to them, whether that be at work or outside of it. As you can imagine, if it was doable for some to work and feel this way, even while their colleagues were stuck in the survival zone, I wanted to know, was this something that anyone could learn to do? What was the source of that aliveness that they radiated? How did they maintain that spark, especially in high-stress environments? And perhaps most importantly, how did they seem to live a fulfilling life without losing their foothold on success? Simply put, the answer is yes. Anyone can learn how to work more reliably in the standout zone. But be forewarned, it's not as simple as working less and resting more. To help you understand how to stop spinning your wheels, there are a couple of truths that I must acknowledge. First, you can run on fumes in the survival zone for a long time. Second, you can accomplish great things even when you're exhausted. In fact, what is clear from the data is that people working from the survival zone often meet the same performance outcomes as those working from the standout zone. Unfortunately, this leads people to believe that the only reason they are achieving their outcomes is because of the trade-offs they are making. However, exhaustion and excellence are not mutually exclusive. As such, it is also true that you do not need to be exhausted to accomplish great things. The biggest difference between the standout zone and the survival zone isn't what people achieve. It's how people meet those goals. In particular, what their work days look like and what their lives feel like are very different. Consider the following differences between the two. When working from the survival zone, generally, you rarely feel you have enough time for the important things in your work and life. When working from your standout zone, you generally make time for the important things in your work and life. In the survival zone, you typically feel a compulsive push to work. In the standout zone, you generally feel a positive pull toward work. In the survival zone, you tend to have loose work-life boundaries, so you feel like you should respond to work at all times, compared to the standout zone, where you tend to set clear work-life boundaries, so you're better able to respond to work at appropriate times. Generally, working from your survival zone means you tend to say yes to every request, regardless of your priorities. In the standout zone, you tend to say no to requests outside your priorities. In the survival zone, you often feel guilty, anxious, or distracted in other parts of your life when not working. When working from the standout zone, it means you usually feel present and engaged in other parts of your life when not working. And when you're stuck spinning your wheels in survival mode, you generally feel like you've never done enough. When working from the standout zone, you generally know you can't do it all. What would be possible if you worked more consistently from the standout zone?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.